Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Good morning. Welcome to worship. I'm Pastor Dan Bodine. This is Pastor Bob Gehrke. And we're glad you're with us. Today we're focusing on God's grace and it being sufficient for our needs. We're focusing on Mark chapter 5, our gospel reading, and how we can come to God in despair and we can exchange that despair for hope, which is a beautiful thing. A couple quick announcements before we get started. The July newsletter is now available for pickup. You can grab one on the table on the outside the doors here. We also have them on the cabinets outside the office. Next to that is also a little map. I didn't bring mine with, but it's a map of the parade route. And the Manitou Day Parade is this Friday, July 2nd. And we'd love to have people join us to hand out some candy as we advertise our Vacation Bible School. We'll have the bus going too, so if you'd rather ride the bus and help the bags go out the door for the candy, that'd be great too. The parade route is listed on the map as well as our staging area. We are in staging area B, which is the green spot. So I hope you can join us around 5:30-ish. The parade starts at 6:30, and we'd love to have you join us. Also this week, on Tuesday, June 29th, we have a parent information meeting for all the parents of 6th to 12th graders. And so we hope you can join us for that as we kind of show what the coming year is going to look like for youth programming and the National Youth Gathering a couple years from now and all that kind of stuff.
Next year, yes,
absolutely. We also have a youth event coming up on June 30th as well. Check your announcements. You may have noticed, or may not have noticed, the pew cushions are back underneath you. And that's wonderful, I think. The elders made that decision this last week, and so hopefully it's a little more comfortable for everyone. And then you mentioned an ordination today.
Actually, an installation. Reverend Demelis. She's an Ethiopian pastor, and we are as a church body going to be bringing together several Ethiopian congregations that will be under his pastoral leadership at Emmaus Lutheran. That's on Lexington down by Como. Last week, Paul Leader, who is a member at Oak Hill, Woodbury campus, offered to pick up anybody who wanted to go with him or if they wanted to ride. And so he's going to be here at 11:15 in our parking lot if anybody wants to ride. That will be at noon today at Emmaus Lutheran Church on Lexington. And then they're going to have an Ethiopian dinner afterwards too. So if you'd like to go, please plan on going and joining our brothers and sisters in Christ with that ministry down there as well. And I just want to also just remind people that we are still technically encouraging people to wear masks. And that, of course, is totally up to you. But until our state gets to 70%, we will be encouraging that. So just want you to be aware of that. With that being said, we will worship unless you had another announcement.
That's it. Let's sing.
Let's sing.
Thank you.
We gather together hearing the words that God it declares for us to be spoken when a person is baptized, to remind us that when we are baptized, we become children of God, given the promise of eternal life and our sins forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. I will extol you, O Lord, for you have drawn me up and have not let my foes rejoice over me. O Lord my God, I cried to you for help, and you have healed me. O Lord, you have brought up my soul from Sheol. You restored me to life from among those who go down to the pit. Sing praises to the Lord, O you, his saints, and give thanks to his holy name, for his anger is but for a moment, and his favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may tarry for the night, but joy comes with the morning. Confident that God's favor is for a lifetime and that joy comes with the morning, let us confess our sins to God, our Heavenly Father. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, I admit and confess my sinfulness. I have turned away from others in my thinking, speaking, and doing. I have done the evil you forbid and not done the good you demand. I do repent and am truly sorry for these, my sins. Have mercy on me because of the obedience of your Son. Forgive all my sins, and by the Holy Spirit, move me to serve you faithfully. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In today's gospel, Jesus answered the prayers of a synagogue leader, Jairus, and a sick woman because they trusted him. Our Lord left his heavenly riches and became poor so that he could not only cure illness and physical death, but by his death and resurrection, offer us the riches of heaven. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks be to God. Amen. O Lord, have mercy. O Christ,
have mercy.
O Lord,
thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, during his earthly ministry, your Son Jesus healed the sick and raised the dead. By the healing medicine of the word and sacraments, pour into our hearts such love toward you that we may live eternally. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for our readings.
The Old Testament reading for the fifth Sunday after Pentecost is from the third chapter of Lamentations. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for a man that he bear the yoke in his youth. Let him sit alone in silence when it is laid on him. Let him put his mouth in the dust. There may yet be hope. Let him give his cheek to the one who strikes, and let him be filled with insults. For the Lord will not cast off forever, but, though he cause grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he does not willingly afflict or grieve the children of men. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading is from 2 Corinthians, the 8th chapter. We want you to know, brothers, about the grace of God that has been given among the churches of Macedonia. For in severe test of affliction, their abundance of joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. For they gave according to their means, as I can testify, and beyond their means, of their own free will, begging us earnestly for the favor of taking part in the relief of the saints. And this, not as we expected, but that they gave themselves first to the Lord, and then by the will of God to us. Accordingly, we urge Titus, that as he has stated, so that he should complete among you this act of grace. But as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all earnestness, and in our love for you, see that you excel in this act of grace also. I say this not as a command, but to prove by the earnestness of others that your love also is genuine. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you by his poverty might become rich. I do not mean that others should be eased and you burdened, but that as a matter of fairness, your abundance at the present time should supply their need, so that their abundance may supply your need, that there may be fairness. As it is written, whoever gathered much had nothing left over, and whoever gathered little had no lack. This is the word of the Lord.
If you are able, please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. Holy Gospel, according to St. Mark, the 5th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered about him, and he was beside the sea. Then came one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name, and seeing him, he fell at his feet and implored him earnestly, saying, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." And he went with him. And a great crowd followed him and thronged about him. And there was a woman who had had a discharge of blood for 12 years and who had suffered much under many physicians and had spent all that she had and was no better off, but rather grew worse. She had heard about the reports that Jesus had done and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his garment. For she said, "If I touch even his garments. I will be made well. And immediately the flow of blood dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. And Jesus, perceiving in himself that power had gone out from him, immediately turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my garments?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing around you, and yet you say, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, and fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, there came from the ruler's house some who said, "Your daughter's dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." And he allowed no one to follow him except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. They came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and Jesus saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. And when he had entered, he said to them, "Why are you making a commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. But he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. Taking her by the hand, he said to her, "Talitha kumi," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." And immediately the girl got up and began walking, for she was 12 years of age. And they were immediately overcome with amazement. And he strictly charged them that no one should know this, and told them to give her something to eat. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated as we sing our hymn.
may be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Have you ever noticed how your reading of the Bible changes as you change as a person? For example, in my life, when I was a child, I really latched on to when the Bible talked about being a child of God. Or like when I was in college and I was in a fraternity, all of that brotherhood language Paul uses in the epistles jumped out at me. When I was getting married, that whole husband-wife relationship of Jesus and the church came to life. And it wasn't until I had children that I started to really understand that God the Father perspective as provider and protector sort of thing. And that's how the Holy Spirit works. That's why you're able to dive into Scripture and continue to find something new every time you read the Bible. Not because the Scripture's changed, but because you have. And God is continually shaping and forming your faith, growing you as His faithful follower, because God loves you too much to leave you just as you are. Thankfully, God is able to use your life experiences, good, bad, indifferent, over the years to help you deepen in your understanding of who God is and to better know of His great love for you. And I realized this when I found myself wrestling with our gospel reading for today. And I noticed that I was looking at it through the eyes of a parent. When I read Mark 5, 21 through 43, I found myself standing in Jairus' shoes, or more accurately, his sandals. And I found myself identifying with this ruler of the synagogue. He was a churchman, and he had a family. And just for fun, I want you to try to put yourself in that father's shoes. Try to imagine what he might have felt coming to Jesus to save the life of his little daughter. Maybe he was feeling desperate. They've tried everything, and she's not getting better. What are they going to do? Then he goes to Jesus. And what's the first thing that Jairus does? It's recorded for us that Jairus falls at Jesus' feet. This ruler, this respected man, seen as an authority and held in high esteem by his community, is bowing down. Or as Jeremiah writes in Lamentations, he put his mouth in the dust and he humbles himself, bowing down to this homeless preacher with a reputation for being a miracle worker. In this act, he was humiliated. And nobody would look at him the same ever again. But none of that mattered because Jesus has agreed to help. And with that comes this ecstatic moment of hope. And so they head off. But then they get delayed. As this woman, in a sense, kind of pickpockets a healing from Jesus. Without his consent, this woman sneaks up on Jesus and takes life and healing from him, and the whole trip stops. Now, if I was Jairus at that point, I would be furious. How dare this random woman, this unclean woman, distract Jesus from helping, from healing, from saving my daughter? Who cares about some bleeding? My daughter is dying. And yet it's during this delay that Jairus learns that his daughter has, in fact, died. And perhaps in that moment, Jairus' anger might have shifted from the woman to Jesus himself. If he would have just stayed on task, she wouldn't be dead. If he hadn't gotten distracted, my daughter would still be here. But then perhaps guilt would have washed over him like a wave. I wasn't even there when my little girl died. Thankfully, in that moment somewhere, Jesus speaks words of hope to Jairus. Do not fear, only believe. But Jairus' perspective isn't the only one to consider when reading this portion of Scripture. What about that poor woman with the bleeding? How do you think she might have felt? In the book of Mark, we hear that this is a problem she's been dealing with for 12 years. 12 years! And just to make sure we're all clear here, this is very likely a gynecological issue. And the folks of her community and the earliest listeners of the Gospel of Mark, they would have been very aware of what it says in Leviticus chapter 15 concerning her medical condition. According to Leviticus 15, she would have been seen as unclean, which was a very big deal for them. Not only that, anything she touched would have been unclean. Anywhere she sat was unclean. The bed she slept in would be unclean. And if anyone else touched anything that she had touched, they would become unclean. And so because of that, she would have been ostracized from her community. Everyone would have gone out of their way to avoid her. Can you imagine going 12 years without so much as a hug or a handshake? Imagine how lonely she must have felt, how ashamed she would have been. It's not like this woman hadn't tried to get better. She had multiple doctors try to treat her. But sadly, we learn it only got worse. Now, in those days, for you to be able to be treated by a doctor meant that you were a person of means. You had money, and lots of it. Most common folks those days never went to see a doctor their whole lives. And we hear that this woman was treated by not just one doctor, but by many. In fact, this was such an issue that she had spent all her money to try to get better. All her money, which at some point was probably a lot. And so like Jairus, this woman with the bleeding problem was probably just as desperate as he was, because she too was a person with no hope. Nothing she tried had worked. She needed a miracle just as much as Jairus, and wouldn't you know, there happens to be a miracle worker walking in her town. Because look, here we have Jesus, and he's walking around, and he's dispensing free medical care. No one was paying Jesus for his services, and he was the best doctor the world had ever seen, as long as you could get him to focus on you. But you see, that wasn't the case for the woman with the bleeding disorder who had to stand at a distance. She didn't get Jesus to focus on her. Instead, she decided she was going to touch his cloak and be healed. And that's human nature, isn't it? We try and we try and we try and we do things our own way. And for the most part, we get along. We have food to eat, water to drink, a place to live, cars that get us from point A to point B. And God's always kind of over there, off to the side. And we only really turn to him when we have a problem. A problem that's much bigger than we can handle on our own. The terrible car crash. The unexpected diagnosis. The sudden unemployment. But even in those moments, we try and we try and we try to do things our own way. All the treatments are attempted, all the possible solutions exhausted, yet often we find we only make things worse. And in those moments, when we come face to face with some of life's toughest questions, We attempt to answer them all on our own, and that only makes things worse. Maybe you've wondered, why do bad things happen to good people? Why do bad things happen to good people? And some folks have tried to answer that question, and they put forward a number of different answers. One of the answers being, well, God doesn't care, which we know isn't the case. Another answer, he's not powerful enough, but we know that's not the case either. The third answer, we deserve to have this happen to us. Believe it or not, answer number three is actually the closest answer to the truth. Because the reality is that we are all bad people. I don't say this to make you feel bad, but the truth of the matter is that we are made bad by our sin. And all of us are guilty of sin. We all have things we aren't proud of, things we're ashamed of, and we carry that guilt with us. I had a friend from college, a fraternity brother named Mike. And a while after graduation, he got stomach cancer, and eventually he died. This happened while I was attending seminary, so I didn't get the opportunity to see or talk to him before he passed. And I regret that, because at his funeral, the pastor giving the sermon mentioned that near the end of his life, Mike was asking if he was going to go to heaven. He wanted to know if he was good enough, that he had done enough to earn a place in the presence of God forever. And the people around him assured him that he was a good person, and yes, he would be in heaven when he dies. And much of his funeral was focused on what a great guy Mike was. But I regret that I didn't talk to him before he passed, because I would have told him the truth. No, Mike, you weren't good enough to get into heaven. I'm sorry, but you didn't do enough to be in the presence of God forever. Sure, you've done some nice things. You've been a wonderful dad to your young son. You've been a faithful husband to your wife. But you aren't good enough to get into heaven all on your own. And that same thing can and be and should be said of all of us. The reality of the situation is that your sin has disqualified you. It's disqualified me. It's disqualified all of us. None of us deserve God's grace and goodness, and yet, God continues to shower us with his goodness. Because thankfully, our God's love is bigger than our sin. Jesus' sacrifice on the cross was good enough to pay for your sin and mine. If I was able to talk to Mike, if I was able to deliver his funeral sermon, I would have included the fact that Jesus is what makes us good enough to be in the presence of God forever. And it's faith in what Jesus has done, faith that was created by God in the first place, that delivers that salvation to us poor, pathetic excuses for humans. It's God's grace and God's grace alone that is sufficient. And it's God's grace that's poured into the lives of Jairus and the woman with the bleeding problem. Now, it's possible the community of people from our gospel reading, they may have thought that Jairus was good enough to have his daughter saved by Jesus. He may have been seen as righteous and upright and deserving of the blessings that come from God, right? Because he's a ruler of the synagogue. He's closer to God and a professional churchman. Surely he was good enough He wasn't, but he might have been seen that way. But the random woman with the bleeding disorder? No, she certainly was not seen that way. No, she was seen as dirty, unclean, and unwelcomed because of her blood. She was an outcast, someone who was detested and rejected. And here we have Jesus helping and healing both of them. Not because they're worthy of it, because they aren't. But he provides the healing and the salvation on account of his love and his grace. And because of his love and his grace, God not only provides the healing and salvation, he also provides the faith needed to deliver that healing and salvation. Because notice what heals the woman and what Jesus says. It wasn't the touching of his garments. In fact, by touching Jesus, Levitical law would have mandated that Jesus was made unclean by this woman. But her uncleanness did not affect Jesus. Rather, Jesus' healing affects this woman as she is made clean by Jesus. And specifically, it's because of her faith in Jesus. As he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." So, as long as you have faith, you too will be healed. But we need to be careful with a statement like that. Because one could conjecture or draw the conclusion that I just have to have enough faith to be healed. And if I'm not healed, well, then I guess I don't have enough faith. Meaning that it's all my fault. But your healing, your salvation, it doesn't depend on how great your faith is. No, what Jesus is getting at here, is that her faith was the means by which Jesus' healing was delivered. The outpouring of Jesus' power and grace was able to come to her and provide the healing because faith was present. I want to point out, too, that faith being present is also what brings Jairus' daughter back to life. Jesus told Jairus, "Do not fear, only believe." Notice, Jairus didn't argue with God. He didn't force him to follow his timeline or to do the things in the way that he thought they should be done. He simply took Jesus at his word, followed his instruction, and Jesus restored his family. There's one last observation I want to share with you from this text, and it has to do with how the family is portrayed. Did you notice what Jesus called the woman being healed from her bleeding? He called her daughter. And with those words, he restored her back into the community as one of the family of faith. And the relationship of Jairus and the little girl raised from the dead, it's Jairus' daughter. But there's one more detail that has to do with family here that you might miss. And it's the fact that Jesus spoke Aramaic in the home. That's what the language is that Jesus is using when he said, "Talitha Kumi." But why is that important? You see, the people of Israel in those days spoke three languages regularly. They spoke Greek for commerce, Hebrew for religious instruction, and Aramaic in familial or family settings. And Jesus is raising the dead little girl in the language of the home, the language of the family. Jesus is using the same language as the lullabies sung by her mother, because this person Jesus raises from the dead is also part of his family of faith. Jairus, on account of his faith, his belief, welcomes back his daughter to his family. And in that moment of watching their little girl stand up, Jesus shows his power and his love. And for Jairus and his wife, their despair turned to hope. And their hope turned into reality. For the bleeding woman, her despair turned to hope, and her hope turned into reality. And for us who are beaten down and beleaguered by this broken world, our despair can also be turned to hope because of Jesus. And we too can expect that our hope will also become a reality because of Jesus. So if you're discouraged, if you're tired, if you're weary, if you feel like there's no hope to be found, look instead to Jesus. Call out to Jesus. Fall at the foot of the cross. Put your mouth in the dust and trust. And if you don't feel good enough to be loved by God, well, then you're in good company. Because we are exactly the people Jesus came to save. We are the ones made righteous by his death. We are the ones given faith to believe. And we can exchange our despair for hope, knowing that no matter what happens in our lives, we too will be raised from the dead and be given life forever with him. To God be the glory. Amen. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. I invite you now to stand with me as we make confession of our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated as we continue with the gathering of our tithes and offerings. As you may have seen as you came in, or as you will see on your way out, we have a box available for you to drop your offering into if you brought it here in person. You also have the opportunity to give electronically. You can text any dollar amount to 84321. Be sure to select South Shore Trinity. You can give on the website at sstwbl.org/give, or you can use the Church Center app from your smartphone. We now give to God as he gives to us as we hear a short offertory from Jeff.
As we continue with our prayers on page 7, we also recognize that there are a variety of people that we are praying for, found printed on pages 10 and 11. Friends in Christ, I urge you all to lift up your hearts to God and pray with me, as Christ our Lord has taught us and freely promised to hear us. God our Father in heaven, look with mercy on us, your needy children on earth, and grant us grace that your holy name be hallowed by us and all the world through the pure and true teaching of your word, and the fervent love shown forth in our lives. Graciously turn from us all false doctrine and evil living, whereby your precious name is blasphemed and profaned. Lord, in your mercy, may your kingdom come to us and expand. Bring all transgressors and those who are blinded and bound in the devil's kingdom to know Jesus Christ, your Son, by faith that the number of Christians may be increased. We especially pray today that you would be with Reverend Demolish as he is installed at Emmaus Lutheran with our sisters and brothers in Christ in the Ethiopian Church. We also ask, O Lord, that you would be with all who will gather together for that special service and for that ministry. We also ask that you would be with our missionaries, Fung and his family, Sinuan and his family, Carl and Stephen, and Yesleta Lutheran Mission, our preschool, and so many others as we seek to share that love of Jesus Christ, because you have sent us to share this good news with those who are yet to hear and believe in you. Lord, in your mercy, strengthen us by your Spirit according to your will, both in life and in faith. In the midst of both good and evil things, that our own wills may be crucified daily and sacrificed to your good and gracious will. Into your merciful hands we commend a variety of different people. We pray, O Lord, for your blessings on Dick, on as we rejoice with Joanne. Pray for Bethany as she recovers, Meredith, Mary, Verna, Donna, David, Darlene, Philip, Robin. For those with cancer, Michael, Olivia, Morris, Daryl, Brad, Dick, Susan, Will, Tammy, Doreen, Pat, Kathy, Christy, Kip and Jana, Sally, Jill, Bill, Diana, Deanne, Dan, Gary, Pastor Norb, Melody, Sarah, Betty, and those we name in our hearts. We pray for all those who are in need, and as we also rejoice with those who have received healing, praying for them at all times, thy will be done, Lord, in your mercy. Grant us our daily bread. Preserve us from greed and selfish cares, and help us trust in you to provide for all our needs. Lord, in your mercy. Forgive us our sins, as we also forgive those who sin against us, so that our hearts may be at peace and may rejoice in a good conscience before you, and that no sin may ever frighten or alarm us. Lord, in your mercy. Lead us not into temptation, O Lord, but help us by your Spirit to subdue our flesh, to turn from the world and its ways, and to overcome the devil with all his wiles. Lord, in your mercy. We also pray, Heavenly Father, that you would be with our leaders, that you would guide and bless them in all that they do, that you'd be with President Biden and his cabinet and our Congress, that you'd be with Governor Walz and our legislators as they seek to have a balanced budget for this coming biennium. We ask that you would give them wisdom and guidance. We also pray, O Lord, for your blessings upon our local leaders as well. Continue to give all those who are leaders wisdom and guidance that they may lead for the good of our communities, for justice, for grace and love as is possible. We also pray for our Supreme Court justices and justices throughout the land as they seek to interpret the laws, that justice may be at hand. We also ask, O Lord, for your blessings upon our first responders, upon the police, the fire, paramedics, and all who serve, those in the medical communities and other places, as they seek to help people who are in need in any number of different ways. That your love, that your law and justice may also prevail. Lord, in your mercy. We trust you, O Lord, in your great mercy, to hear and answer us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand if you are able. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We continue by sharing, once again, our Growing in the Word Bible passage. Be still, and know that I am God. Psalm 46, verse 10. And receive the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. We sing our sending hymn.